Hello, my name is Jason Laney, and I'm a meteorologist at the National Weather Service in El Paso, Texas. And today on Weather Basics, we're going to be talking all about the sun and how it affects the weather here on Earth. I know what you're thinking. Obviously, the sun is important when it comes to a discussion of weather because the sun determines whether it'll get hot or not. Well, that's true, but the sun is responsible for, oh, so much more. We like to say that the sun is where it all begins because the sun drives every aspect of weather, whether it be pressure distribution, the movement of air called wind, the water cycle, the development of clouds and rain. If it's weather, it was created somehow or another by the sun. The first thing that we need to talk about when discussing the sun and its relationship to weather is exactly the role that the sun plays. Now, we know that the sun is this huge mass of energy, and it's constantly emitting that energy out into space. Some of that energy actually reaches the Earth, and it reaches the Earth through a transport means known as radiation. Now, there's something that you need to understand about the solar radiation, or the incoming radiation from the sun. Our atmosphere doesn't do a good job absorbing it. As a matter of fact, incoming solar radiation that we refer to as shortwave radiation, which is visible light and primarily ultraviolet type radiation, which can be dangerous, well, that passes right through the atmosphere and it reaches the Earth's surface. Now, when this solar radiation is absorbed at the Earth's surface, something very interesting happens. The Earth begins to heat up. So unlike the air that doesn't absorb incoming solar radiation, the Earth does. And one of the laws of radiation tells us that a good absorber is also a good emitter. So what happens is the Earth turns around, takes this heat energy, and re-releases it in the form of long-wave radiation, most of which is sensible heat known as infrared radiation. And believe it or not, the Earth's atmosphere, the air around us, it can absorb that type of radiation. So basically what happens is the sun heats the Earth, but it's the Earth that turns around and heats the air. Now, this is precisely why the air closer to the Earth's surface down here where we live is typically a lot warmer than the air up above us. That's because the heat source for our air actually comes from the Earth. But it's the sun that heats the Earth that drives all of this. So let's take a closer look at incoming solar radiation and how it is actually received at the Earth's surface. It turns out that the sun is so immensely large in comparison to the size of the Earth that incoming rays of solar radiation travel basically in parallel lines. But remember, the Earth is not flat. The Earth is curved. So incoming solar radiation right in the middle of the Earth near the equator is absorbed directly. However, incoming solar radiation up towards the poles, be it the northern or southern hemisphere, comes in at an angle, a much lower angle, mind you. As a result, less radiation is received. So at the equator or near the center of the Earth, more incoming radiation means more heat energy for the atmosphere eventually. However, higher latitudes with lower incoming sun angles or angles of solar radiation, well, things obviously are going to be a little cooler there. So let's take a closer look at this on our globe. And we're going to start off with the situation that would be the first day of spring or the first day of autumn. We refer to these as the equinox. That is when the sun is directly over the equator. And when the sun is directly over the equator, that's the location where the incoming solar radiation is being received most vertical with an angle of 90 degrees. Sun doesn't get any higher than that. However, as you venture north or south of the equator, the incoming solar radiation comes in at increasingly lower angles. And remember, lower sun angles mean less energy received, which in turn means less energy to warm the air. Now, this would seem to indicate that it's always going to be hot at the equator and always going to be cold at the poles because the equator gets the most sun, or at least the greatest sun angle. And in general, that is the case, but you may have noticed that it isn't always the same year-round. Things change, and that's because the Earth is tilted on its axis. The Earth's axis of rotation is tilted at a 23.5 degree slant. And what happens is part of the year, the northern hemisphere is actually facing the sun, receiving the greatest incoming solar radiation, and that's why in the northern hemisphere it's hot during summer. While in the southern hemisphere, where the sun angles are much, much lower, it's just the opposite. It's winter time. And as we all know, it's not always summer, and it's not always winter. The seasons change. So basically, what's going to happen is 6 months later, the Earth is going to be tilted the opposite way in relation to the sun, meaning that the southern hemisphere is getting the most direct incoming solar radiation, and it's warmer. While those of us living up north, like us in the United States, well, we turn out to be colder. Now, before we go any further, I don't want to give you the misconception that Earth's tilt on its axis is actually wobbling towards the sun and away from the sun. No, that's not the case at all. It turns out that the Earth's tilt on its axis is a constant, but the Earth's position in relation to the sun is not. You see, the Earth is on the move. The Earth is actually revolving around the sun. It takes, what, 365 days to make the entire journey? So this image more or less explains how we have our changes in seasons, because while the Earth's northern hemisphere may be tilted away from the sun on the first day of winter, as it makes its journey around the sun, eventually on the other side, the northern hemisphere is tilted towards the sun. And this cycle of seasons continues, and this results in a constant changing of the way that the Earth's surface is being heated by the sun. So to quickly recap, we have the sun heating the Earth, and the Earth heating the air. But the Earth doesn't heat the same all over. There's changes in latitude because of the curvature of the Earth. There's seasonal changes in the way the Earth heats up because the Earth doesn't stay in the same place in relation to the sun. And of course, the Earth is tilted on its axis. But there's more to it than that. Believe it or not, even areas that receive the same amount of incoming solar radiation could heat up differently. We're talking about the differential heating of land and water. You'll notice that in this particular image, we say that land heats up faster into higher temperatures than does water. Consequently, land cools off faster into lower temperatures than does water. So to kind of put this in perspective for you, imagine this. We're taking a nice little walk out on the beach. And as we're walking across the sand's been receiving the incoming solar radiation, the land gets hotter, right? And our feet are beginning to burn in the sand, so what do? We rush to the water to put our toes in the cool ocean waters, and they are indeed just that much cooler because water doesn't heat up as fast. Now, if you're doing the same thing at night, you're walking across the sand may feel kind of cold to your feet because land also cools off faster than water does. But you stick your toes in the water in comparison is going to feel rather warm. So at this point, you may be asking yourself, so why does all of this uneven heating of the Earth's surface really matter other than for determining where it's going to be hot and where it's going to be cold? Well, as this map shows, it affects so much more than that. This is pressure distribution just in general around the Earth. And notice there's areas of high pressure and low pressure. And while we won't get into that here because that's the topic of another Weather Basics video training session, we do want to note that uneven heating of the Earth's surface leads to uneven pressure distribution. And that too can be important because air moves from high to low pressure. And when the air moves, we call that wind. So yes, the sun not only determines heat, it determines pressure and determines the movement of the wind. So hopefully by now you have a much better understanding of how the sun affects and influences weather here at the surface of the Earth. Now, if you'd like more information on this topic, be sure and check out the links that we provided below. And don't forget, there are lots of other wonderful weather basic videos waiting for you.